Okay, good afternoon. My name is Tom Glazier, and I'd like to welcome you to the New America Foundation, to what I hope and expect to be a fascinating discussion about fact-checking and misinformation. It's part of our Delve into 12 series and grows out of some work that we've done on fact-checking and misinformation over the last several months. I lead our work here on media policy as part of a team housed within New America's Open Technology Initiative, where we have been considering how the changing media and technological landscape affects citizens' participation in a democracy. There have been many reports about journalism and media over the last few years, including the Knight Report on Sustaining Democracy in a Digital Age, the Downey Shudson Report on Reconstructing Journalism, and the more recent FCC report, which was led by Steve Waldman, and I believe there are a couple of people in the audience who contributed to that. The Knight Report starts on the premise that individuals need three things to participate in a democratic society: relevant and credible information, the education needed to engage with that information, and opportunities to participate. Our event today focuses on the first of those three items: relevant and credible information. Without facts, or if we consider it more narrowly, with misinformation trumping facts, our democratic processes are at risk. It is with this in the back of our mind that we have undertaken a program of work that has resulted in the release of the three reports, which you may have picked up on the way in. The reports address respectively the modern history of fact-checking. Michael Dobbs, the founder of the fact-checking column at the Washington Post, wrote the first. He subtitled this, "How Reagan Inspired a Journalistic Movement." Jason Reifler and Brendan Nyhan have co-authored a paper on research findings from social science, and Jason will join us on the panel today. Don't get too optimistic about what he has to say. It seems our minds aren't easily inoculated from misinformation. Lucas Graves and I have added to this and crafted a paper built on research that we've done and research provided by Morningside Analytics that provides some analysis of the fact-checking universe as it stands in late 2011, early 2012. So our event today will begin with Lucas describing our work. This will be followed by a panel and Q&A moderated by Steve Cole, the president of the New America Foundation. Before I start, I should mention that this event is being live streamed, and everything is on the record forever, or at least, as I vaguely said, as long as Google Anonymous or WikiLeaks can find it. For those on Twitter, please use the hashtag DelveInto12. During the Q&A, please do also wait for the microphone. As I mentioned, we have an online audience, and we want to make sure they can hear us. So without further introduction, I'd like to invite Lucas Graves to the podium to share his thinking. Lucas, are facts alive and well in 2012?
Thank you, Tom. So what I'd like to do is just frame the discussion that we'll have today with some of our research about the media footprint of fact-checking. But I thought I would take just a moment or two at the outset to talk about what exactly the new class of fact-checker does. There's been a lot of confusion, a lot of discussion lately about how fact-checking differs from and how it relates to traditional journalism. I'm sure many of you read this column in the New York Times from public editor Arthur Brisbane, asking whether the Times should be a truth vigilante. Brisbane said he wanted to ask readers for input on whether and when New York Times reporters should challenge facts that are asserted by newsmakers they write about. Now, based on the fairly heated response to this column, his readers seem to think that that's what the newspaper was supposed to be doing all along. But in fact, in practice, fact-checking, the new kind of fact-checking, begins where traditional journalism leaves off, for the most part. And we can talk about why that's the case and if that has to be the case. So let me just give you my version of a day in the life of one of the new fact-checkers, which starts precisely with scouring traditional media for claims that politicians make, fishy things they say that go unchecked. So here's a typical example, which is courtesy of factcheck.org. This was a Times piece from last March, reporting on a speech given by Mississippi Governor Haley Barbour. In the third paragraph, Barber made a pretty bold claim to slam the Obama administration. He declared that in the last 2 years, the federal government had spent $7 trillion, even as the economy lost 7 million jobs. And he added a little witticism. I guess we ought to be glad they didn't spend $12 trillion. We might have lost 12 million jobs. You know, a punchy point, and one that is almost a perfect example of what fact checkers call checkable facts, which they spend a great deal of their time looking for and harvesting from conventional news outlets. The reason it's a perfect example is that, first of all, it's pretty clearly not a matter of opinion. Secondly, it's a numerical claim that's based in hard data that can be checked against an authoritative source, in this case, the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And third, and most important, I think, from the time that I've spent watching various fact-checking groups, it involves a major political figure who at that time was considered a possible presidential contender. You know, political fact-checkers, like political journalists generally, see their core mission as informing citizens who are facing choices at the ballot box. So a quick trip to the BLS website would have revealed that, in fact, Barber had basically doubled the actual job loss statistics. So the next day, factcheck.org ran this piece, fairly bluntly contradicting Barber's claim, explaining that he had grossly exaggerated the nation's job losses under President Obama. Barber is dead wrong about job losses in the last 2 years. He's not even close. So this is the kind of ruling that fact-checkers make. To back this up, the report, or this piece, linked to two different sources of government data. It linked to a transcript of Haley Barber's speech, and it linked to the New York Times piece that had reported on the speech the day before. It did not, interestingly, call out the New York Times for failing to challenge this very easily checkable claim, and I think that's typical of the mainstream fact checkers who don't spend a lot of time criticizing their colleagues in the mainstream press. Instead, they just concentrate on filling in the gaps. So this is what the new fact checkers do. They rule on claims that political reporters either don't have the time to analyze or don't feel comfortable weighing in on. Now, we can have a long conversation, and I'm sure we'll touch on this today, about why they don't feel comfortable weighing in on these questions. I think the answers are more complex than critics sometimes maintain. But the other really important thing that fact checkers do, that they spend a lot of time doing, Bill, I hope you don't mind that I picked this older photograph, is that they try to get as much attention as possible for their work, especially in traditional print and broadcast news. For fact-checking to make a difference in public discourse, for it to be able to name and shame politicians into giving up misleading claims, political actors have to pay attention. And there's good reason to think that that's most likely when the media, especially the traditional media, large-scale print and broadcast outlets, are paying attention. And that's where things get interesting, because as any fact-checker will tell you, once it's out there in the wild, their work is immediately subject to some pretty intense partisan filtering. Politicians and pundits talk up the fact-checks that they like, and they ignore or dismiss the ones that they don't. And you can see this clearly in the media footprint of different fact-checking groups. So this is a chart showing how different broadcast networks, different cable and broadcast networks, cited various fact-checkers over the last 3 years. It's based on Nexus searches. So in blue, at the top, you see citations by MSNBC. In red or orange at the bottom, you see citations by Fox News. And in the middle, in various shades of sort of green-gray, are the you know, the traditional objective news outlets like NPR and CNN. I realize not everyone agrees with that designation, but you know, they consider themselves objective journalists. And what's fascinating is that nonpartisan fact checkers like PolitiFact and FactCheck.org get the great bulk of their attention from nonpartisan news outlets. So that's the great big gray swath in the middle of the two bars on the left. In fact, both PolitiFact and FactCheck.org get a fifth or less of their attention from the openly political outlets, Fox News on the right and MSNBC on the left. Meanwhile, the politically oriented fact checkers and media critics, like Media Matters, which goes after what it calls conservative misinformation, and Newsbusters, which goes after liberal bias in the media, get the great bulk of their attention, more than two-thirds, from those partisan news outlets. So they're really speaking to the echo chamber. What's fascinating, though, is that this partisan attention actually crosses the political divide. So Media Matters for America, for instance, which is the third bar, gets even more attention on Fox News, which is the primary target of its critiques, than it does from its allies at MSNBC. Now, the same basic phenomenon can be seen in the online footprint of these different fact checkers. You can read about this in our report. I'm not going to explain in detail the methodology depicted here, but this is a map of the blogosphere's conversation about political fact checking. Like the blogosphere itself, it's divided into two very distinct political hemispheres. So sort of in blue on the left, you see progressive and liberal blogging clusters. And in various shades of red and pink on the right, you see their conservative counterparts, the conservative blogosphere. And if you look at the map of attention to particular fact checkers, you see the same kind of politicization. So here's a map of the sites that pay attention to Media Matters, which again is dedicated to combating conservative misinformation. And you can see that it penetrates really deeply into the liberal corners of the blogosphere, and it draws just a small but intense core of attention from the conservative side of the blogosphere. That's almost certainly critical attention, negative attention, people disputing Media Matters findings. And in contrast, let me emphasize the contrast again, Newsbusters on the right penetrates really deeply into the conservative blogging world and gets a little bit of attention, again, doubtless negative attention, from liberal sites. So here's a distillation of, and again, this is in our report, of that same data across the board for a variety of fact checkers and media critics working online, arrayed according to the degree of partisanship of the attention that they get online, the sites that link to them, the bloggers that talk about them. And you can see pretty clearly that the fact checkers that are dedicated to being nonpartisan, like PolitiFact and the Washington Post fact checking column and factcheck.org, have actually done a pretty good job of speaking to both sides. So they're right there in the middle of the conversation, getting attention from both sides, whereas the more openly political fact checkers are off on the margins. Now, the really interesting question that I think we'll talk a little bit about today is what happens as these fact checkers become embroiled in political controversies? Can they maintain that central position, or will they be pulled to the margins of the conversation? So for instance, as I'm sure Bill Adair will be happy to talk about, PolitiFact has come under a storm of criticism lately from liberal figures in the media and on blogs. And the question is how that affects its footprint and its influence. It's a question, I think, that affects all of the nonpartisan fact-checking groups who have to resist or try to resist being pulled into these sort of political media wars so that they can continue trying to make a difference in public discourse. Thank you.
Okay, I'm not sure who's responsible for the chair arrangements, but why don't we have the panelists come up on stage. I'm Steve Call from the New America Foundation. I'm your friendly moderator today. We're going to have a conversation and invite you to join it in just a little while. I thought I would just, listening to Lucas's good work, just pull back a little bit and reflect on why we're interested in fact-checking, particularly in this election year, and why we're interested in New America. And I think there are a couple of reasons, though many different perspectives and the group up here come to the subject from lots of different angles. But I thought I would mention two for myself. One, of course, as a journalist and thinking about journalism and the crisis in journalism, what's interesting about the fact-checking movement, the self-conscious groups that have sprung up, PolitiFact and FactCheck among them, is that it's really, you could argue, it's the first organic response by journalists to the crisis in their own business. This was the idea that there is a self-conscious fact-checking movement on the land was not a sort of top-down initiative of media company owners or even universities and nonprofits. It grew out of a kind of a marketplace and a history for this dedicated truth-telling and watchdogging that predated the business crisis in journalism, but then accelerated as a response to it, I think, among a lot of journalists. And so the question is, where is it going? Is it a durable movement? Does it have a role that is similar to the kinds of roles that mainstream media newsrooms claim for themselves in earlier eras? What are its limits? And it's just an interesting subject because it's the first time that something constructive has emerged from journalism about journalism since the crisis in business models really accelerated after 2007. And then I think the second and perhaps more relevant reason we're interested here in this election year is because we live in a post-Citizens United world, and we know that enormous amounts of money are flowing into our political discourse, often without accountability attached to them, often invested in distorting ads that are directed at voter behavior, and where various kinds of factual or putatively factual claims are made. And there's a question of whether our public square, our citizenry, our institutions can hold the falsehoods and the arguments that are made with this surge of money accountable, clarify them, help voters make sense of them, and also whether, as social science, it's possible to even interfere with the distorting effects of negative advertising. And all of that is sort of on the table, I think, for the conversation today. Let me start with the social science. Actually, why don't you all just introduce yourselves rather than me make a long piece of it. Jason, why don't you say a word about why you're here and the work you do that's relevant to this conversation?
Okay, my name is Jason Reifler. I'm an assistant professor of political science at Georgia State University. Go Panthers. And I've done a lot of work with my co-author, Brendan Nyhan, who's at Dartmouth College. And we started a research program several years ago trying to get at the question of when people have factual beliefs that are incorrect, is it possible to correct those factual beliefs? And our first study came up with an unfortunate answer, which was no. And not only is it no, that in some cases, correcting people can actually make factual misperceptions worse. We've subsequently done a little bit more work, and we have some glimmers of light on the horizon, that there may be ways in which we can improve factual beliefs. But we are still in the early stages of really trying to figure this out, and it's a big challenge ahead.
So the research you're doing now is designed to determine whether there are kinds of messaging that not only avoid the reinforcement syndrome that you documented in your first study, but might actually change people's perceptions?
Yes.
And are you testing out a variety of hypotheses about how that might work?
So there are a number of different ways in which misperceptions may be especially difficult to correct. Some of them have to do with how human memory works and how people encode information when they receive it and how difficult it is to correct that. Some of it has more simply to do with presentation of information. So in a paper that we're still working on, that we hope will be published soon, we found that giving people information in graphical form has proven in our three studies to be a reasonably effective way to try and get people to accept factual information. It also seems that one of the things that makes people so resistant to factual information is that, as psychologists would say, people's self-concept is tied up with the factual beliefs that they have. And when you directly try and challenge those factual beliefs, it brings to mind defense mechanisms to try and prevent their self-concept from being attacked. It can be very threatening to say things that you think are very important about the world. And if you're somebody who cares about politics, being told that your political beliefs are incorrect, it's the type of thing in which you're likely to say, whoa, not so keen on that. And so we've started investigating how buffering people's self-esteem can make them more open to counter-attitudinal information. So we're building off of a very active research paradigm.
So one last question, then we'll move down the line. In a Citizens United world, it's commonplace, even before Citizens United, it's commonplace in professional political advertising to assert, I assume on the basis of evidence, that negative advertising works. This is a fundamental belief in the political consulting business. In what way that's relevant to your investigation does negative advertising work, as a matter of fact? In other words, is the distortion of facts central to its effects, or are there other ways in which it's demonstrated that such advertising strategies are effective?
That's a very large question.
Well, so give me a very short answer.
So the very short answer is negative ads are effective, and there are a variety of reasons why they are effective.
And where do lies fit in that palette of reasons and effects?
I'll have to get back to you on that one.
Okay. All right. So, Bill, you've been around the fact-checking business for more than this cycle, and there's been an enormous amount of attention paid to the advertising strategies of the super PACs simply because of the running room that they enjoy in this cycle as opposed to previous ones. Start by saying a little bit about your work. Tom alluded to it, but tell us whether this cycle feels different than the last couple that you've been in. In what ways is your contestation with candidates and interest groups, your work different, and to what extent is it familiar to you from the 08 and earlier cycles?
Sure. I'm Bill Adair. I'm the editor of PolitiFact, which is a project of the Tampa Bay Times, formerly the St. Petersburg Times. I am also the Washington bureau chief for the Tampa Bay Times. PolitiFact started 5 years ago because we wanted to try something new on the web and try a new media initiative and focus on fact-checking. And this grew out of my own guilt. I had covered political campaigns and felt that I had been a passive co-conspirator in sort of passing along inaccurate information and hadn't fact-checked it the way I should. And so I went to my editors with a proposal that we would create a website where we would do fact-checking full-time and we would rate the statements on a truth-o-meter from true to false. We later came up with our even lower rating, Pants on Fire. We now have 10 state PolitiFact sites employing about 35 full-time editors and reporters. So there are 35 PolitiFact journalists around the country who have published now a total of 5,000 truth-o-meter fact checks, which I think makes us the most prolific fact-checking organization maybe in the history of journalism. That's not a high bar in that I don't think there's been that much fact-checking until Brooks Jackson got fact-check started in 2003. To answer your question, Steve, it does feel different, and it's really interesting. It's in 2008 when we started. The 2008 presidential campaign was our first campaign, and we focused exclusively on that. And we were focused naturally on the candidate committees. That's where most of the action was. There was some independent groups that were speaking up. There was also this chatter from chain emails that we've all gotten from our crazy uncles that say things like Barack Obama's a Muslim and he won't say the Pledge of Allegiance or put his or wear a flag lapel pin. And we checked a lot of those, and those were actually important messages in the 2008 campaign. And if you talk to Kathleen Hall Jamieson at the Annenberg School, those are going to be are going to play a big role again this year. But what is definitely different this time are the super PACs and other groups that are really becoming so much the surrogates for the candidate committees, and are being used to do the negative advertising in the same way that really the candidate committees used to do that in the past. And we just looked today, there's an ad just went up today in Super Tuesday States attacking, this is from the pro Gingrich super PAC. And I can never get them, I can never remember them. One, they both end in our future, and like one of them is restore our future and the other is saving our future or something. This is the pro Gingrich one. But what's different is there is less accountability of course of who is spending the money for these groups. But really the art of the campaign commercial is the same. And the fact check is very much the same. And in some cases, these super PACs will actually provide some backup materials to try to justify their negative claims. The one point I guess I would make about negative advertising, and then we can talk more about this in the future later on, is negative does not necessarily mean wrong. And one of the things that we did when we started PolitiFact was to do fact checking that acknowledged some things were true. And what we try to be guided by in selecting what we fact check is if you as a viewer hear something and wonder, is that true? And if you're going to ask that question, if we ask that question, then we're going to try to answer it. If we decide through our research, yes, it's true and we rate it true, we'll still publish it. And one of the things about other kinds of fact checking is it has kind of been limited to zingers, like let's get them only when they get something wrong. And we see our mission more as let's satisfy their curiosity. And if it's true, we'll say so. And the result of that is another feature of PolitiFact, which is the report card. You can look at anybody's report card and see how many true, mostly true, et cetera, ratings they've gotten. And so I think there's value in that, because if you're seeing that Restore Our Future ad and you're wondering, is that true, and you see that we've said it is, that empowers you as a voter.
Well, we want to talk about this lie of the year thing, but maybe we'll do that a little bit later if we hear from the others. Well, while we're on this subject, do you find that there's any difference in the impact you can create? If one of our interests here is to defend the public square, defend fact-based discourse as a basis for voter decision-making and political competition, and your role is contributing to that, do you find that there's a difference in the impact you can create online and in the way people hear your work when you are calling out a politician who has directly spoken something false in a speech or in a debate on the one hand versus ad watch work on the other hand, which is murkier, sometimes difficult to even access all the ads that are being broadcast since they're not routinely distributed. And so in any event, you do both. You call politicians out on claims they make to each other or before audiences, and on the other hand, you try to track the advertising piece, but it almost feels like the advertising piece is a tsunami that is very difficult to do anything more than stick your toe in.
It is, absolutely. Obviously, if we call someone out on words they spoke at a campaign event, they're much more likely to react to us, to respond, to give us their backup materials to back it up. With the campaign ads, it's a much more calculated decision, I'm sure. The producers have huddled in a dark room, making these ads often in a matter of an hour or two. These ads are often made very quickly. And they've made a calculation. What do we got? They put it up there, and I think it is a calculation. We're going to do this, and you know, PolitiFact and FactChecker are going to hit us, but let's take it because we want to get that message out.
Yep.
So I think it's much more of a calculation. We've had, you know, a fair number of examples where people, when we give them a false or a pants on fire, will say, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't realize that was wrong, or I misspoke, or whatever, and they will, you know, correct themselves, and we don't see that very often for campaign ads.
Right, exactly, yeah. So Wendell, your background is a little bit difficult to describe. I think Tom likes to say you've come over from the dark side to help clarify for the rest of us what goes on over there. But say a word about your own professional background, what you're doing now in think tank land, what kinds of concerns you are. And then talk to us about your perception of how the media is actually doing in the face of the misinformation campaigns that are mounted by private industry, individual corporations or political groupings that are funded by private interests. To what extent, realistically, is the media making a dent in these strategies?
Right. I didn't always work on the dark side. In fact, my first career, I was a journalist myself, and I was a reporter here in Washington. I covered Congress in the White House for a few years, and I did a little bit of, I guess you would say, fact-checking to a certain extent. 5 days a week, I was a reporter, but I got a chance to write analysis pieces on the weekend. And I would try to put things in context and go beyond traditional reporting and what I would write on the weekends for Scripps Howard News Service. I spent my longer career, though, in public relations and wound up in the health insurance industry, where I spent 20 years, first with Humana, and then with Cigna Corporation, and I was head of corporate communications at Cigna when I left my job after a crisis of conscience. It finally dawned on me that what I was doing for much of my job, and not just for Cigna, but for the industry, was often the exact opposite of what I was trying to do as a journalist. I felt that when I was a journalist, I had an obligation and tried to report fact. Much of the time, admittedly, it was a he said, she said kind of a story. But again, I always tried to make sure that I was reporting what I thought to be true, and on the weekends, try to put things into context and call out things that weren't necessarily true that had been said on the House floor or the Senate floor or in the White House. I left in 2008, not knowing what I would do. I just knew I didn't want to keep doing what I was doing. I had been a part for many years of efforts to influence public policy. I spent quite a bit of time down here working with trade associations for the insurance industry and in coalitions that were put together and front groups that were created to try to influence public opinion for the purpose of influencing public policy. And I just realized I was doing the wrong thing. I clearly was on the dark side. I more or less.
You were good at it, huh?
And I was pretty good at it. I mean, I was. I could have probably coasted out my career and had a pretty cushy retirement, I guess, if I'd stayed there. But I left in my late 50s, and it was after going to see something that I never would have thought that I would be seeing in this country that kind of jolted me. That was a kind of an epiphany that made me have this crisis of conscience in the first place. I was having doubts about a lot of what I was expected to say about the insurance industry before I had this epiphany, but I didn't have the, I guess, the final push to make me really confront it. I went to back to visit relatives in Tennessee and visited a health care expedition, as it was called, a few miles from where I grew up in Southwest Virginia. It was, I read a story about it in my hometown newspaper that I used to work for many years earlier, about people expected to be coming by the thousands and driving 500 and 600 miles away to get care that's being provided free by doctors and nurses who were providing care for over 3 days. And I went there out of curiosity. I had been working on a position paper, a white paper for the insurance industry that was to try to persuade people that the problem of the uninsured was not so much of a problem after all. If you slice and dice the data in certain ways, you can make people think that a lot of people are uninsured because they are that way by choice. They just don't want to spend the money to buy coverage. But what I saw when I went to this healthcare expedition was people who had jobs who would love to have had coverage, but they couldn't afford it, or they couldn't get it at any price because of the policies of the insurance industry, refusing to sell people coverage with because of pre-existing conditions. Many of these people worked for small businesses that couldn't afford to offer coverage anymore to their employees. And these people were getting care that's being provided in barns and animal stalls. And it looked like something you could never have imagined seeing in the U.S. People lined up by the hundreds waiting to get care in barns and animal stalls and under tents, soaking wet because it was raining. And these were the real long lines. Part of my job in the industry was to try to persuade people that you don't want to have anything to do with a system like a Canadian system or a system in the UK where people have to wait long periods of time to get care. These people were waiting hours and hours to get care in barns and animal stalls, and they were waiting once a year when this event came to Wise County, Virginia.
So just to take you to this kind of campaign cycle and the media's performance in it, from that very powerful kind of conversion experience, when you're now back on the other side identifying with journalists and citizens in the face of these strategies, what do you see about the limits of their effectiveness or the strength of the strategies that you left behind in corporate communications?
The media has, I think, is very ineffective in pointing out incorrect information and being able to challenge it. When I was in my job in the industry, increasingly what I was able to say went unchallenged. At the beginning of my career, there were more reporters who were doing investigative reporting who were really looking in and covering the healthcare industry or health insurance industry much more aggressively. But by the time I was no longer, toward the end of my career, even the New York Times was not bothering to cover the earnings announcements of the big companies. And very few reporters would ever challenge anything that the companies would put out there. And it was certainly that way in the political arena as well. And I noticed that certainly during the debate on healthcare reform. There was very little investigation of things that were being said during the debate. And one thing I learned as I spent a lot of time here in Washington on Capitol Hill and also observing media coverage is that there's very little understanding of how the commercial insurance industry operates on Capitol Hill. And most members of Congress don't have a clue. And most reporters don't either. Reporters often are fairly junior or just don't have the time to really come to understand the topic they're covering.
Before I invite Chris back in, Bill, just to follow up on that observation, how often do you find that checking corporate communication is relevant to the mission you've sort of assigned yourself, explicit corporate communication?
We've done it when it has involved a major public policy issue, such as the banks and particularly the auto companies and the bailout. And in that case, we've checked claims by the heads of GM and Chrysler about claiming they had fully repaid their loans. And I think in both cases, I think it was a half true or maybe a mostly false. And to me, this is another area where there needs to be more journalism. And I agree with Wendell. I think when I look at the amount of scrutiny that that companies are getting, not just in healthcare, but in so many industries, because of the depleted ranks of journalists, there just aren't as many smart reporters who have the time to learn what they need to learn and ask tough questions. And so, we should be fact-checking them too.
Right. Now, Chris, I'm not sure how many folks here have a sense of the context of the work you presented, but there are papers, I think, out on the table. This project of research that Chris has been leading, we were very fortunate to collaborate with him, that Lucas is a PhD candidate or a PhD holder?
Candidate.
A candidate at Columbia University in the communications department, and was already engaged long before we took an interest institutionally in this subject in mapping the fact-checking universe in the United States and trying to understand it as a sort of element of journalism, did some very interesting field research in Philadelphia, I believe, yes?
Philadelphia and in D.C.
And so these papers that are coming forward now over the last couple of weeks are really an attempt first to just document what's happening and map it, and because there really hasn't been a sort of objective effort to describe how this movement is emerging, what its shape is, and the very rigorous data-based work that Lucas has led us through with help from, is it Morning Analytics or Morningside Analytics? Is fascinating. So I, those of you who have a professional reason to look into this, the depths of those cluster charts are endlessly interesting. And if you work for a media company and want to understand how your media brand is positioned in the blogosphere, left, right, and center, there's a lot of findings that were presented during the development phase are very interesting. But anyway, these three papers are the first round of research that we've offered, and Lucas has been a real leader in organizing it and conceiving of it. And I guess the question I wanted to ask you is, as a mapper of this movement and someone who has chronicled it since before it acquired this visibility, what do you see in this election cycle, and particularly the super PAC cycle, that strikes you as new or emerging about fact-checking?
I guess that, I mean, I'm really interested, my dissertation is about fact-checking as a kind of reform movement within journalism, which is, as Steve so rightly pointed out, is sort of one of the most interesting and substantial movements born of journalism recently that tries in a very self-conscious way to deal with sort of changes in the information environment and with something that's always been a challenge to the conduct of objective journalism, which is how do you grapple with misinformation and still maintain your stance as an objective reporter. And what's so fascinating about PolitiFact and FactCheck.org is that they very much hew to the idea that they are journalists, they are objective, and yet they're going to depart from this practice that is so often characterized, elite journalism, of not weighing in on whether something's true or false. And I think the challenges that they faced in doing that are some indication of why journalists have traditionally been so reluctant to take these questions head on, right?
It's not something you can do in 30 minutes on deadline.
It's not something you can do 30 minutes on deadline, and it's also something that invariably provokes a fair degree of dissatisfaction out among your readers and out in the world of the politicians that you cover. And the danger is that even though you're hewing to the truth, you end up being perceived as a political actor. And it's easy to say, if you were to say, for instance, well, in that debate, a Democrat was clearly lying, more egregiously than the Republican, or two presidential candidates, then some people are going to take that at face value, but many other people are going to assume that you are biased. And they're going to say, how can you accuse the Democrat of lying? Clearly his policies are better. And it's very difficult for people, as I think Jason and Brendan's research shows, to depart from their own political convictions when they analyze this kind of information. And so journalists have adapted to that, over the decades. And now it's normal in objective journalism to steer clear of these questions.
So you're very objective about the limits of objectivity, which is
a
good sort of aspect of your. You presented in your opening remarks the example of the ombudsman's column, where he seemed to maybe walk past an opportunity to accept that in an ideal world there would be more of this embedded in every column of the newspaper. But what do you think, knowing and hearing from journalists about the reality of deadline political reporting, where you're out of speech
you've got to file 45 minutes after the speech is over or sooner, you have no easy way to confidently call a judgment about a claim about an obscure public policy matter in a speech. So what do you think ought to be best practices in the newspaper columns that you read and the cable television news reports that you absorb?
Or even in routine, I mean, the real question is whether in just a straight reporting article, like that article written by Jeff Zeleny about the speech by Haley Barbour, you know, should it be acceptable for a journalist to say, well, the governor said this, and in fact, that's not true, or that's a lie, or that's an exaggeration. I mean, there are different ways to phrase it. And I think that, you know, we can all agree, and most journalists who I talk to agree that that's an admirable ideal, I think it's something that we're seeing actually emerge in journalism. You're seeing more of these routine fact checks being incorporated into straight reporting, sometimes by citing dedicated fact checkers like PutAFact and factcheck.org, which is what's so interesting about their work. But they have to be very cautious in undertaking this. For one thing, because if they do it too hastily, then they will invariably, walk into minefields. All the fact checkers have ended up, having to tweak their rulings at some points when they rule too hastily on something, and they're doing this full time. So it's a human endeavor, and it's difficult. And also because there's a risk that even if they get it right, they alienate their audiences, and they will alienate their political constituencies. And that, I think, is the real danger that has to be sort of managed in a careful way as journalists start to do this.
Jason,
more.
Do you have anything to add about that danger? Is it offensive to audiences to have that explicit of a ruling as opposed to the more traditional journalism format of simply recording what someone said accurately at an event? Do you have an instinct about that or data?
We don't have data on that specific question. My instinct would be that, yes, people don't like being told that they're wrong, but my other instinct is that's probably not so bad, because if you're in this sort of standard world of he said, she said, and somewhere else in the same story or same newspaper, there's an article of the somewhere where the opponent's claims are being accepted uncritically, that's just as offensive or just as aggravating. So I would be less, that there are reasons why embedded fact-checking may be problematic. In fact, one of the hopes that Brent and I have is that we'll, over time, be able to develop a nice toolkit that will allow people to make fact-checking more effective. And if we're lucky, Bill will work with us on that. I won't actually make you answer, put you on the spot. But in terms of actually having it embedded in the stories, I don't fear the alienation perhaps quite as much as Lucas, but he's more of an expert on journalism markets than I am.
Well, by the way, my former Washington Post colleague Michael Dobbs just snuck into the back. So during the during the reception that follows, you can chat, I hope, with all these folks. But Michael's paper about the history and the rise of fact-checking is one of the papers we've already released, in addition to the two that we're releasing this week. And we had a very interesting argument when we were meeting about the subject, not in public earlier, about whether the origins of fact-checking go all the way back to I.F. Stone or not, or where you date the beginning of this kind of self-consciousness about fact-checking. But anyway, this last discussion does lead us back, and this will be my last question. We'll take a few from the audience, and then we'll let you talk to each other and join a reception. This lie of the year business, because the transition in my mind from the discussion we were just having is it really so bad to have contestation over what is true? That is, can't we all just belly up to the bar and fight about whether or not an assertion is true or false? And isn't it the nature of truth, not to use the in the capital T sense, too grandiosely, but isn't it in the nature to argue about it, to search for it, to refine arguments until you feel satisfied that you've come close to it? Obviously, you know, particle physics is objectively unshakable, true or false, but quite a lot of the other things we debate about are not, especially in politics. So I use that as the introduction to what was the nature of the argument about your lie of the year.
Sure.
And what was your defense? What was the criticism? What was your defense?
I'll probably let Wendell make the criticism because he was one of the people who was critical about it. But I guess I'll explain first of all what we're talking about when we say the lie of the year. So PolitiFact, as I think most of you know, rates statements on a truthometer, and each statement in our database is rated from true to pants on fire. And part of the what is unique about PolitiFact and different than factcheck.org, which was our inspiration, is that we wanted to provide different new media ways of presenting information to help you as a voter, as a member of in our democracy, of knowing how things are. In the past, fact-checking was a series of long articles that unless you had read them all, you wouldn't know, well, does so-and-so get a lot of things wrong, or what sorts of things does so-and-so get wrong, or whatever. So the way we made PolitiFact was by doing ratings on our truthometer and then compiling those ratings on a person's report card. Once a year, in a year-end package, we name what we consider to be the most significant falsehood of the year, and we call it the lie of the year. And we have done that three times, and the first, all three have involved healthcare. The first one was Sarah Palin's claim that the Democratic healthcare law contained death panels. The second one was the claim by many Republicans that the Democratic healthcare law was a government takeover of healthcare. And then for 2011, it was the claim by many Democrats that the Ryan budget would end Medicare. And we were not the only fact checker to name this as one of the most significant falsehoods. Factcheck.org did also, naming it one of its whoppers of the year. And Glenn Kessler, who writes the Post Fact Check column, also named it as one of the most significant falsehoods of the year. We, though, took the lion's share of the criticism from many liberals who thought that it was a reasonable description of what the Ryan budget would do for Medicare. And this set off a tremendous, even beginning when we named our finalists, we got tremendous opposition about it. And our reasoning, the same as the reasoning for the Washington Post and for factcheck.org, was as stated, at least in the times that we rated it, it was not accurate that the Ryan budget didn't end Medicare, that it did indeed, as we acknowledged in the article, drastically change Medicare, but it didn't affect Medicare for people who were 55 and older. And it was very much a claim, as we know, that was targeted at senior citizens to scare them. And this was part of a tactic that has worked very well for the Democrats by scaring senior citizens about Medicare. And if you look back at the history of campaign advertising, you can go even into the 1950s when the first tactics were used to scare senior citizens. In that case, it was about Social Security, with images in campaign ads of Social Security cards being torn up. So we published that. We decided, as did factcheck.org and the Post, that it was a very significant falsehood. And
the significance that you attributed to it was primarily because of the implication that current Medicare beneficiaries of the current system would in fact not be affected by the voucher changes,
yes,
because that was the primary part,
and the secondary part was that indeed there was a program that under the Ryan budget, now this was before his new plan with Ron Wyden, which retains conventional Medicare, it would also retain a Medicare-like program into the future. Now this is where Wendell objected that in the view of Wendell and many other readers who wrote to us, hundreds, I mean, I don't know, I didn't remember the count, but it was well over 1,000 emails that we got, and hardly any were positive about our, our decision. In their view, it was making such a drastic change to Medicare that it was a true statement. And in fact, Think Progress had a headline that got repeated many times that said, PolitiFact's lie of the year is actually true. And so anyway, we stirred up a fuss with that, and I think Lucas touched on something, that the nature of this kind of journalism is you put yourself out there. This is a gutsy form of journalism, and by making these calls, whether it's an individual fact check or a kind of year-end conclusion like that, you're gonna face a lot of criticism, just as we have lately with some other ratings. And that, as Lucas pointed out, and a friend said to me yesterday, that's why not many people get into this business. Because we're in the business where in a single day, with two ratings, we can alienate both halves of our audience. You know, and what kind of a business model is that, you know? So
do you think substantively, in terms of, obviously you have a thick skin for this work, or you develop it, do you now feel that much more confident about what Medicare reform actually amounts to and doesn't amount to than you did before you got into this fight? I mean, have you learned something more about the truth as a result of arguing your position?
No, I mean, I think we had reported this very thoroughly before we made the call. And, you know, it's important to recognize this was based on 11 fact checks that we had done over the course of the year. So I don't feel we needed to learn anything more about it. The lie of the year is an award for the most significant falsehood. And so we know at that point we had already determined it was false. We just had to determine how did it stack up compared to the other falsehoods of the year. And there weren't, in our view, others that came close to this one.
Right. So Wendell, do you want to add to the, or give direct voice to the criticism that he attributed to you?
Yeah,
maybe he soft-pedaled your views
right,
a little.
And I certainly didn't want to be a critic because I so admire what PolitiFact and the other fact-checkers do. But I felt strongly that this was not a lie, because the Ryan plan would, in my view, not just in my view, but it would fundamentally change the Medicare program. Certainly not right away, not immediately. But over time, it would. And when you are moving to a voucher support system or a premium support system, and the incentives that would be in place to essentially ultimately privatize the program and change other elements of it, it is, in essence, doing away with the Medicare program as we know it eventually. It would take time to do it. But it would indeed do that. That was my point of view. That if you are, and I began my piece with saying, if you have a car that you were marketing as a Ford, for example, and you change the engine of the transmission and you try to market it as a Ford, it's not a Ford anymore. It's something else. While you might be able to call Medicare under these changes, it would be a fundamentally altered program, to the point that I didn't think it was dishonest to say that it would be ending Medicare. Not immediately. There's no doubt that that's true. It would not immediately affect current seniors or those getting all that close to being Medicare eligible. But for others who would be coming into the program in later years, they would be finding a program that is quite different from what seniors for the last 40 more or more years have known it to be.
Great. Thank you. So let's take a couple questions, and then we'll let you, this gentleman was up first with the, and don't, do if you can, identify yourself, and remember there's a live audience.
My name is Mark Nadell. I wanted to follow up on two things that Wendell mentioned. One was, you said when you were a reporter, on weekends you'd be able to write news analysis where you could put the news in context, and I assume you could express your opinion. But during the week, it sounded like then you didn't put the news in context. And my understanding is a journalist, my definition of journalist is someone who reports the news in a way by putting it in context to help people understand it. That's one. Second is, I was disturbed when you said that so many people, reporters, don't understand the healthcare industry, the insurance industry. It's such an important policy area. I'm wondering, are there veterans like yourself, retirees, whatever, who could be available to give a course at the Nieman Center or some other foundation, that journalists who are going to be reporting on this and affecting, you know, the policies we vote on can be more informed and thereby inform us better on what's happening. Is there any work on this?
Yeah, good, Wendell.
When I was a reporter, I did, as I was writing, try to provide context as I could, as I had the time to do it. A lot of the stories that I wrote, I actually had to phone in to dictate the stories, and a lot of journalism is done on very short deadlines, and often you don't have the luxury of time to be able to provide the context, and often you don't have the space to fully explain a story, or just don't have the mental ability at the moment when you're running such deadline to do as thorough a job of providing the context as I think you'd like to do. So I think there are those constraints that sometimes work against a reporter providing adequate context for every story he or she writes. Having more time to write a column for Saturday and Sunday, though, for the papers that carried my column, gave me a bit more chance to think about the story that I was writing, or the commentary that I was writing, the analysis piece that I was writing. So part of it is just the way journalism has to be in terms of meeting deadlines and being the first with a story if you possibly can, if that is important to your news organization. And certainly with online journalism, I think that's become even more of an imperative to try to be the first to do a story. When I was in the industry, in the insurance industry, and was dealing with reporters, it was very important for the wire services to be the first to report Cigna's earnings to the business world. But they had a formula for doing it. There was little context. They were looking for certain things that they could just plug into a story, and it was just kind of a race to see who could actually get that story out. But there was very little analysis of what was really going on with the company's earnings. Yeah. To your second question, I don't think many people who have left the business world who had an earlier journalistic career to provide. I would love to do that, to tell you the truth. I've thought about doing that. I just haven't taken the time to explore doing that. But one of the things I am doing now is kind of returning to my, I am now an analyst at the Center for Public Integrity, and I write commentaries once a week for the Center for Public Integrity. My columns are picked up elsewhere. They appear in the Huffington Post. But I would like to do exactly what you were suggesting.
Right. There's someone here in front.
My name is Cammy Burt. I'm with the Pakistani Spectator. I was just wondering that if you have done any analysis about Tea Party and Wall Street Occupied group, there are impressions that somehow all Wall Street Occupied are druggies, homeless, jobless, and all Tea Party peoples are kind of racist or anti-Muslim. You could draw a parallel, if you go to RNC, in a receptionist area, you always have black faces, like at the Heritage Foundation. But once you go beyond that, it's business is run by, very white, nice, like you guys. So whereas you go to DNC, you would see real America in Bill Clinton's world.
Right.
Michael Steele did make RNC real America, but now it's the same thing. So I was just wondering that if you have any fact checking about Wall Street Occupied versus Tea Party dudes. Okay. Thanks.
There's a chain email that's been circulating that makes some claims about this that is preposterous, I'm sure, but difficult to validate. And what it says, and it's written clearly by supporters of the Tea Party, that number of rapes, murders, various things that occurred at Tea Party rallies compared to Occupy rallies. And as somebody who covered cops, night cops in Tampa and some other places, and working with police departments, you know how hard it is to collect data like that. And so I'm sure the data, or I guess as a fact checker I should say, the data is very suspicious, but we're not able to verify it. Because I don't know, how do you define an Occupy rally in terms of time and location? And the amount of research you'd have to do for those would be it'd be a tremendous amount of research to try to do that. So that whole concept has circulated from the Tea Party perspective in a chain email. And this is one of our challenges is, as fact checkers, trying to have three full-time writers. In fact, I should recognize Martha Hamilton, who's our deputy editor, is there, and Becky Bowers, who's one of our writers for PolitiFact National. And we try every day to try to put new content on the site, but if we were to tackle something like that, you're looking at a project that would take days, weeks, if it was even possible to do.
Great, Mr. Gentleman, and then we'll take a couple more and let you talk informally.
Hi, my name is Barry Jones. I guess I'm with WPFW because I want to ask about corporate-sponsored media and truth-telling versus listener-supported or viewer-supported media. And specifically, I guess I want to ask about Democracy Now! Since I've kind of cut off the network news.
So I guess you put NPR up there on your screen. Do you see anything about the effectiveness of nonprofit versus for-profit media in here attaining credibility, at least in the ways that you've mapped it, Lucas?
It's difficult to say conclusively whether nonprofit media is more effective or less effective than commercial media, but it is. There are a few interesting things to say. One is that, you know, NPR and other, I think other public outlets have entered into partnerships with different fact checkers. So I think PolitiFact has a message machine partnership or did with NPR. You know, so they're avid consumers of this new journalistic resource. You know, your mention of Democracy Now! I think is interesting because traditionally, one of the first places where you saw something that looked like fact-checking journalism was within the partisan press, and this, you know, this was Steve's reference to I.F. Stone previously. I mean, he did pieces that sometimes looked a little bit like fact checks. You know, he would take a political statement and say, you know, whether it was true or false, usually false. So it's a kind of journalism that has rested more comfortably, more easily, in alternative media, in progressive media or conservative media, but, you know, in media that openly has a political viewpoint. And I think you see that in Democracy Now! So they do, you know, they do segments that seem a little bit like fact-checking and that they will openly contradict political claims. That's exactly what makes the project of PolitiFact and factcheck.org so interesting, is that they, you know, they want to take those claims head-on also, but outside of an openly political context, right? So they want to bring that back into the fold of objective journalism.
Yes, there's a woman there in the front. Did you have a question? No.
John Adams here from the Epoch Times. I'm just wondering if you've seen any effect from having these fact-checking things. First of all, I'd like to thank you for the forum and also for providing that sort of service as a writer. That's very useful. You said that you had a report card. Is this sort of naming and shaming? I mean, there has to be some sort of line where people know they're being watched and they just can't lie anymore. Are you seeing any effect from that in terms of the sort of the stretching of the truth and the number of outright lies out there?
Well, I don't. We're journalists, not social scientists, so I couldn't say there's less lying going on this year than there was in, you know, last year. And it being a campaign year and a post-Citizens United year, it's going to be a whole different playing field. I do have seen a fair number of examples where an elected official or a talk show host will, after we give them a false on the truth-o-meter, they will say, yeah, I got that wrong, I'm sorry. And we've heard anecdotally things like Sherrod Brown, a senator from Ohio, telling his staff, I don't want to get any falses from PolitiFact. And that, you know, he cares about his record. We know of several examples involving President Obama where we've given him a false or something, and the next time he'll get something right. So what was a stock line that we say isn't true, he'll stop repeating. However, there are times, like we had one the other day, where we had called him out on a claim that preventive care saves money. And generally, now there are areas in healthcare where preventive care can save money, but generally the folks at GAO and a survey of research by the New England Journal of Medicine or the Journal of the American Medical Association has found that overall preventive care doesn't necessarily save money. And so we gave Obama a false. And he repeated that claim the other day, which surprised us. So, but then you have like Bill O'Reilly. I think we had an example where we gave him a false. He apologized for it. Keith Olbermann, same situation. So so there are interesting insights like that. I guess, and this is sort of the difference between Jason's approach and my approach. I'm a journalist. My goal is not to get politicians to stop lying. I am a journalist, and my goal is to empower democracy. And then you, democracy, can decide what you want to do with the information I provide. And you may decide that you agree with it and that you're going to hold this elected official accountable in ways and not vote for him or her or whatever. Or you may decide, in some cases, you disagree. You might disagree about lie of the year. You may disagree about any particular ruling we make. But my goal isn't to get politicians to stop lying. My goal is to give you the information you need to be a better citizen. And I think that's the role of the journalist. And when we get into this role of, well, we want them to stop lying, I think we sort of get out of the bounds of what is a journalist. Now, I'm interested in Jason and I have talked some and about the kinds of things that fact checkers can do that might persuade people. And I guess our goal is we don't want people to continue having misconceptions about things. But again, I'm not a propagandist. I am a journalist.
So last question there, and then I'm going to call time and let you guys ask your questions informally, which I'm sure the panelists will be happy to take from you.
Thank you, gentlemen. My name is Lorelei Kelly. I actually have a question for Jason. I'm one of these people who would love for our politicians to stop lying, having worked on Capitol Hill in 2003 in the run-up to the Iraq War. My question, I'm from a background in social psychology, and I remember talking to my mentor about the 2004 election, and I asked him how could these sort of extremist and peripheral arguments hold so much weight, and he said, Lorelei, the American public, it's an interesting cultural phenomenon. Americans will tolerate extremism if it's come by honestly, if it's honest extremism, and that was the case with George Bush. I don't know if you agree with that or not, but I think some things that you mentioned earlier about the social psychology aspects of how you come at this problem, I think are really hopeful, and maybe you could talk about them a little bit.
I can try. It's sort of an open-ended question. Of course, the extent to which somebody is viewed as extreme depends on what one's own personal beliefs are. So if somebody shares the same beliefs of any given candidate, they're unlikely to see that person as extreme. And there's a robust debate in political science, the extent to which the American public has polarized and whether people are further apart ideologically. That's certainly one aspect of what's going on. If I happen to be really far to the right or to the left, other people that I talk to about politics that share those beliefs are unlikely to see each other as extreme. I'm not sure that exactly answers your question. There's something else going on, and I'm a little bit hesitant to bring this up, but there are some people in social psychology who say that conservatives are fundamentally different in how they view the world, and that conservatives are far more dogmatic, and that the type of motivated reasoning that Brendan and I have seen in our studies is more prevalent in conservatives. I'm not prepared to go that far yet, in large part because we haven't seen things work for liberals. The backfire effect that we've seen seems to be happening with conservatives, but one of the things that we don't have a tremendously good handle on is what are all the contextual factors that make corrections not only ineffective, but under what conditions will they produce this backfire? I think this is sort of, you know, the flip side to some of what Bill was saying is, you know, he's a journalist, and you know, journalists have time pressures, and they need to be staying with what's in the news right now. And social scientists, like myself, we do things much more slowly, and certainly, I think more slowly than. I wish we could produce our research more quickly. If there's anybody really, really wealthy and wants to give us money to do it, so we can make it
speaking to the camera
quickly.
There, and on that
yes,
note,
if you have lots of money,
yes,
we're accepting donations.
You've all been very patient. Let's give the panelists a round of applause. And we welcome you to stay and continue the conversation informally. Thank you.